in Africa, if not physically, but through NGOs, through spies, through pretenders who come to us and say they are here in Africa to assist us. Even in groups, armed groups on some of our territories. What help is coming from them? Regime change. We are supposed to be free and independent, Mr. Ban Ki-moon. Supposed to be free, the 54 countries. We come to the United Nations, it's ceremonial. Every year, September, we are there. We pay lots of money to go there. And to the General Assembly, we make speeches. We go back home, year in, year out. But the bosses in the Security Council say, you shall never have the powers that we have as permanent members. And we have asked and asked and asked and asked and asked. Reform, reform the Security Council. I want to tell you, Mr. Ban Ki-moon, you are a good man. You are a good man. But of course, we can't make you a fighter. That's not what your mission was. We will fight a fight for our own identity, for our own integrity and personality as Africans. We are Africans. If we decide, as we shall certainly do so one of these days, that down within the United Nations, we are not members of it. Others are real members of it. We are artificial members of it. And we can't continue to be artificial members of it. How can only a handful of people, in fact it's only America and the Europeans, those who say they are white-skinned, because they are white-skinned, anybody else who is not like us shall not have the power and strength, integrity that we have. If the United Nations is to survive, we must be equal members of it. Equal members, members who can say when we go to the body that we are now speaking truly as members with a voice that's understood, respected, and honored. But no, that's not it. We met in Switzerland some years back to discuss the reform. of the United Nations, especially the Security Council. And we came up with Kwazulu-Ini consensus. We have said we want two permanent members with a veto if the veto is to continue, although we don't like that creature called the veto. But if the veto is to be retained, those members must also have the veto. If the veto is to be abolished, fine. They shall be like others. But no, two members, 54 countries here. This is the body of respected people, the body of Africa. So I wonder whether you have told them that we also are humans. tell them that we are not ghosts, that we also belong to the world, and the world called, part of the world called Africa, and Africans shall no longer tolerate a position of slavery by any other name, by denial of right, slavery by being treated in a manner we regard as not equal to the manner in which they treat themselves. I hope you will hear from us on this issue of the reform of the United Nations. But you have done a good job for us. You have visited our countries, you have wept with us where disease has visited us, whether it was Ebola or some other, where calamities have occurred, where fights have taken place, where terrorism also has affected us. We thank you for that concern as a human being. And so that distinguishes you from others. Of course, you don't come from those countries. We know where you come from. Your Excellencies, it is my honor and privilege to express profound gratitude to the government and people of Ethiopia for the traditional warm reception extended to us since our arrival in Addis Ababa. We are very grateful for the excellent facilities placed at our disposal, which should no doubt inspire us to a successful 26th ordinary session of the Assembly of the African Union. Your Excellencies, in line with our aspiration to silence the guns by 2020, matters of peace and security were high on our agenda in 2015. Despite new and recurring challenges, our continent witnessed some notable successes, and overall there was political stability. Notwithstanding the spirited attempts to derail transitional processes by negative elements in Burkina Faso and the Central African Republic, the people of these two brotherly countries remained resolute and committed to constitutionalism. To them we say congratulations and well done. May I also congratulate several AU member states which in 2015 successfully held parliamentary and presidential elections. Once again, we have amply demonstrated that Africa has come of age and that democracy is alive on our continent. The ongoing conflicts in South Sudan, Libya, Burundi, Democratic Republic of the Congo, Somalia, and others remain a source of concern for all, for our organization. Even there, we have of late witnessed some glimpses of hope for peace which deserve our support. While we need to redouble our efforts in search of peace, peaceful solutions to these conflict situations, we at the same time urge our brothers and sisters in the affected member states to put the interests of their countries above all other considerations and give peace a chance. Terrorism has become a major scourge and challenge in many parts of Africa, thus negatively affecting the peace and safety of our people. This evil phenomenon threatens to reverse the gains made in the integration and development of our continent. The challenge for us all is to combine our efforts to fight and defeat terrorism in all its manifestations. Your Excellencies, the creation of the African Peace and Security Architecture amply demonstrated Africa's determination and commitment to ridding the continent of conflict and instability. Central to the AU security architecture is the African Standby Force and its rapid deployment capability. The success of Amani Africa 2 field exercises, which were held in South Africa in October-November 2015, means that we now can deploy the Africa Standby Force as a tool for conflict prevention. This should be no doubt a big step towards the goal of silencing the guns by 2020. Your Excellencies, the Agenda 2063 and the first 10-year plan mark this giant step towards the Africa we want. But the Agenda 2063 is only a first step. Much more remains to be done for our vision to become a reality. We therefore need to collectively work with a sense of urgency to finalize the funding, follow-up, and monitoring mechanisms so as to enhance the successful implementation of our plan. In this regard, we look forward to the consideration by this Assembly of the Progress Report on the implementation of Agenda 2063, and in particular, the Africa Resource Mobilization Strategy, which has been developed by the Commission. Your Excellencies, in all our endeavors to implement this important roadmap, we should never lose sight of the fact that the Agenda 2063 is a people's agenda. It is owned by and belongs to the people of Africa. The popularization of this blueprint at the continental, regional, and national levels is therefore of paramount importance and a responsibility for us all. Equally important is the task of domesticating the plan, ensuring that its synergization and synchronization with our national and regional plans takes place.